If we could take our seats, we're going to begin the next part of the program. Thank you. You could wrap up your conversations and we'll get started. Thank you. So, did you know that Pope Pius XII was Hitler's pope? Nonsense, right? Of course, we know that. Nonsense. But there's a lot of confusion. there is a great deal of ignorance. And unfortunately, there is also a degree of malice, especially in the origins of the slander against this great man. The story is less the story of a pope than it is the story of a man who loved other men and women and took heroic efforts on their behalf. The story is a long story, and it has many avenues. Tonight, we're very fortunate to have with us a man who knows how to shake it up. Gary Krupp is the president and founder, with his lovely wife, Meredith, who's with us tonight, of Pave the Way Foundation. I guess I should really call him Knight Commander Gary, right? There you go, with a star. And what Gary has done is a phenomenal undertaking of research into primary sources, and actually the creation of primary sources by the interviews with people still living, who are present for the events that were really those of the great unsung hero of World War II, Eugenio Pacelli, Pope Pius XII. Gary has written a book and put together his research. He's been kind enough to donate copies of it. They're in the entrance of the church, and everyone's free to take one as a donation from Gary and from Pave the Way Foundation, Pope Pius XII and World War II, The Documented Truth. The website of Pave the Way Foundation also allows you to register with your email and to gain access to these 70-something thousand documents, many from the secret archives of the Vatican and other sources, which demonstrate an astounding and beautiful story of heroism that's unfortunately been shrouded by a veil of, well, let us say, unkind motives. You'll hear about this, you'll hear about the origins of this black legend, and you'll hear about the truth. Why Pius XII and a bioethics lecture? Well, in the 1950s, the great pope delivered a series of allocutions to hematologists, to anesthesiologists, to midwives, and to others in the medical and medical-related fields, in which he undertook an exposition of Catholic thought and Catholic moral theology applied to developing technology, which was changing the face of medicine, is what today we call bioethics. World War II saw the invention of antibiotics. Anesthesia made huge advances. Prior to the war, surgery was always considered an extraordinary intervention in healthcare. Within 10 years of the war, it was hardly ever considered an extraordinary intervention because of antibiotics and because of modern forms of anesthesiology. In the face of those great and dramatic changes in healthcare delivery and technology, a new field of Catholic bioethics emerged, and Pope Pius XII's allocutions are the modern foundation of that field of thought. So in honor of that great pope, of his contribution to the founding of modern Catholic bioethics, we thought this was an appropriate topic, because the highest aspiration of Catholic ethics, of any decent ethic, is the protection of human life. And that's really what the story is about. Gary Krupp is, as I said, I'll let him explain a little bit about what Pave the Way Foundation is, but has done tremendous work fostering relations between many groups of people, especially between Catholics and Jews, but also between other groups and outreach around the globe. He has an organization that is dedicated to the truth, because, as he says, you don't decide truth by a vote. You find the records, and he has them for you. So please welcome Gary Krupp.
First, I want to thank Tom and for inviting us up here and getting me a special visa to come to Connecticut from New York. And this does mean a tremendous amount to us, because Meredith and I are Jewish, and we grew up hating Pius XII and the entire idea about him, because we believed basically the stuff that was the lies that were really spread about him. And as things happen throughout life, God tends to intervene. And that's exactly what happened to us. We, Mary and I, were having lunch with the Vatican's ambassador to Israel in Jerusalem, and then Archbishop Franco, And Yad Vashem had put up a very negative placard about Pius XII, which was historically incorrect. And he said, well, can Pave the Way do something about this? And so I said, well, we'll look into it. I walked out of the residence and I said to my wife, I said, why would I want to do something about Pius XII? And so we went back to New York and we get a phone call from the head of the New York Board of Rabbis, Joe Potasnik, who was actually on my board at the time. And he had said that there was a Jewish journalist from the Washington Post who's written a number of books who wanted to write a book about Pius XII. Would I get him access in Rome? Mary and I are in Rome. We just got back Monday. We're in Rome sometimes 10 times a year. And Sister Catherine knows because we had, you know, so we do travel back and forth a lot. And so he asked me if I would get him access. And I said, look, I don't particularly like Pius XII, but I'm not going to add any more fuel to, you know, to hurt Jewish-Catholic relations. And I really would rather not. So we said, well, why don't you meet him? And this journalist, his name is Dan Kurzman. And so Mary and I went into the city, and we met with Dan. And I said, well, what's your book about? He says, I interviewed General Karl Wolff, who was the commandant to Italy, for Italy, and Heinrich Himmler's deputy just before he died, 1973, I think. And I had a full interview with him, and he told me about the plan that Hitler ordered him to develop, which, by the way, is on our website. We went to Germany and have the actual plan in German, and it's translated. Hitler had ordered him a plan to invade the Vatican, seize the Vatican Museum, the Vatican Library, to kill all of the members of the Curia that they could find, and then to kidnap Pius XII, where he would be taken to Liechtenstein, where he would have been assassinated. Now, this is a very, very important concept. I said, this doesn't make any sense. Wasn't Pius XII a Nazi collaborator? Wasn't he vehemently anti-Semitic? Wasn't he silent and everything? He says, absolutely not. The exact opposite is true. Now we're really getting very perplexed about this. We can't understand it. And then I get a phone call from then the nuncio to the United Nations, Archbishop Migliori, Celestino Migliori. And he said, you know, there's a little nun in Morristown, New Jersey, Sister Margherita Marchione. You ought to take a ride out there and talk to her. And Mary and I then got a visa to go to New Jersey. And we went out to see Sister Margherita, who's a 92-year-old nun about this big, and she's feisty as can be, and she is the one that really started this. She started this back in the 70s. And she started showing me documents, letters, incredible amounts of information, and I said, there's something is terribly wrong here. And then it went from being, I was shocked, absolutely shocked. Then I became angry. I point this out quite often because in Judaism, the worst character flaw a Jew can have is ingratitude. Now, where do we get this from? We get it from the Bible, from when Moses was turning the Nile into blood. He actually couldn't do it himself. He had to hand his staff to his brother Aaron to touch the Nile because that God said that if you do it, it would have shown ingratitude to the Nile, which gave you life. So that's a very important concept. And so we started moving along with this thing, and then we went home, and I started going, anyone can do this. You can go to a computer and go to the archives of the New York Times, the Palestine Post, the Jewish Telegraph Agency, which is the Jewish service, news service for the world for 100 years. All of these, any newspaper you want to, put in Pius XII, Jews, 1939 to 1958. You're going to find hundreds of articles, many of which were saying that the Pope is protesting against the treatment of the French Jews. He's protesting, he's meeting with the chief rabbi of Herzog of Palestine. All of these incredible arguments, articles. Not one negative article. Now, the book you have was actually not really a book, to be honest with you. That was more of a program that we developed because after I started gathering this stuff, and this was back in 2006, I contacted the Vatican Secretary of State at the time because we worked directly with the Secretary of State on this project. And I said, I'd like to hold a symposium in Rome, and I'd like to have about 80 Jewish scholars attend this. And this book is actually the program, or so to speak, the program of it. It talks about the some of the documentation we found. Now, the book, the actual book, which is actually double the size of this, and that's you can get that online if you want to. But that's because we're constantly coming up with new documentation. I'm going to show you something which was very, very important, because for me, this little thing here, I don't know, Sister Catherine, you remember what these are? It's the ID card to get in. This is the ID. One is the ID card to the Vatican Library, and the other is the ID card to get into the secret archives. And Mary and I go in and we do it. Not one of the critics, Pius XII, have one of these, because not one of them have ever come to Rome to actually do primary source research to find out what we found out. And I'm telling you that Pope Benedict XVI opened the archives up in 2006 up to 1939. That has two-thirds of Pacelli's life. All of his actions in Europe, when he was a nuncio in Germany, when he was Secretary of State. And we started gathering documentation. Now, understand something, I did not do this research. I'm not an archival researcher or a scholar, but I'm not an idiot. You know, you start seeing this stuff and you say, wait a minute, there's something is terribly wrong here. And so I went to see Father Peter Gumpel, who is a Jesuit, and Father Molinari, who was the postulator. Peter Gumpel is the relator to the cause, and Molinari was the postulator. And we met with him at the General House of the Jesuits. And he started telling me about some of the people around the country, Bill Duino, Ron Rischlack, Marie, you know, all of the different Dimitri Cavalli, different people around the country who've been doing the actual research, the hard research. And so what I did was, what Pave the Way did, was to gather all these people together with one force. That's why this has succeeded. Because a lot of people have been sort of, you know, sometimes when you have a historian, they do the research and they really don't want to share it, but I force them to share it. Plus the fact that we had a fantastic relationship, Mary and I were very, very fortunate. Just to go back quickly, we had actually the last audience with John Paul II. We brought 168 Jewish leaders from around the world to see him. This was 11 days before he fell ill, and he never had another audience again. But these are the sort of things that we do. And we became friendly with Cardinal Ratzinger. And then when he became Pope, we were actually shocked. And we got to meet with him 19 times and meet with the Cardinal Secretary of State, Cardinal Bertone. And what I did was, I'm brazen. I asked them. I said, you know, the Vatican Library has published the Acts and Documents of the Holy See. This was a study done in 1981. Which has over 5,000 documents, illustrates 5,000 different documents from the war years. I said, nobody knows what's in this stuff, because you have to go here, you have to come here to Rome, you have to buy the volumes, 12 volumes. And I said, can I have a set for nothing? I will pay, Pave the Way, we'll pay to digitize them, and we'll put them on our website and on your website. So if you go to the Vatican website today, you'll find the Acts and Documents of the Holy See. And if you go to my website, you'll do it. And then it didn't just stop there. Then I got Interama Caritas, which was the actual benevolent things that the Vatican did to try to help different Holocaust survivors during the war. We have the Acts of the Holy See from 1909 to 1961. The Vatican sent me all of their microfilm. We digitized it, sent the microphone back, and so on. And then Mary and I traveled around Europe to locate as many documents as we can and to meet with eyewitnesses. Now, if you go to our website, there's a special dedicated page for scholars. And that what it has on there is all of these documents. And we also have L'Osservatore Romano from 1938 to 1945, 27,000 pages. So you could actually read statements that the Vatican had made for this supposedly this silent pope. Everything that we know about this today is exactly the opposite of the truth. And so Mary and I were in Jerusalem, and I had a meeting with the chief rabbi of Israel. And I said, Rabbi, I have to tell you what I found. It's very disturbing, but we have found huge amounts of documentation proving that Pius XII not only was not anti-Semitic, he was actually responsible for the creation of the modern state of Israel beginning in 1917 up until the United Nations vote in 1947. But he was also, he hated the Nazis. He wasn't a Nazi collaborator. We have document after document from as early as 1923. If you go to the book, you'll see where it says that National Socialism is the worst heresy of our time. Constant pieces of information. And so it just completely blew apart everything. Now, what's the problem with this? One would say, well, gee, how come I haven't heard about this? There are people out there that really don't want you to know about it. They're very, very content with maintaining this terrible, terrible reputation. We call the black legend of Pius XII. But what we've done is, because we're doing now, we're now not instead of having 15 or 20 people doing this as individual, we have one person doing it together. All of these people are part of our little group. You'll see their names in some of these documents, Bill Duino, Michael Hesseman, and so on. These are the people that actually go to the archives and dig this stuff out. They're the ones who get the credit for this. And I can't stress this enough, that there are documents there that are so compelling that you would have to be an idiot not to understand what they say. Just to give you an example, you know, when the arrest of the Roman Jews on October 16th, I don't know if that document's in this volume, I think we may have gotten that afterwards, but October 16th, 1943, the Germans started arresting the Jews of Rome, and Pius XII, we followed all of the things he did that day, but he met with a German, the ambassador to Germany, von Weizsäcker, saying the arrest must stop immediately. And he said, there's nothing I can do about it. And so what he did was, he sent his nephew, Carlo Pacelli, to meet with a German sympathizing bishop by the name of Hudal, who was an Austrian bishop. And he ordered Hudal to write a letter to the governor general of Rome, General Rainer Stahl, that the arrest must stop. And if they don't stop, he's going to speak out vehemently against this arrest, these arrests. Now, why was that? What purpose did that have to stop the arrests? Remember, I mentioned before that there was a plot to kidnap the Pope, kill the Curia, and seize the Vatican. Every German military man knew, on a military basis, had that happened, had Hitler ordered the invasion of the Vatican, that would have been catastrophic throughout Catholic Europe. There'd be riots all over the place. And the Germans are trying to fight the war, and then they'd have to put down the riots. So they knew militarily it would have been absolutely impossible to deal with it. So what they did was they did everything to discourage Hitler. Now, how did they do this? Von Weizsäcker had said that he had sent these very positive, this one critic by the name of Sergio Minerbi, who claims, well, look at the telexes from von Weizsäcker to Berlin saying the Pope is on our side, the Pope. And then von Weizsäcker actually admits, he says those were dedicated lies. They were calculated lies in order to keep Hitler from ordering this arrest. So Pacelli actually used this as a mechanism to get General Stahl to stop the arrest. Now, what happened? We know exactly what happened because we have the original document is on our website. You can download it. It's written in German, signed by Hudal, and it was carried, hand carried by Salvatorian General Pancratius Pfeiffer, and it was delivered directly to General Stahl. And in that, he said to him that if the arrests don't stop, the Pope is going to speak out. And then Stahl knew that he would have to do something. And so he telephoned Heinrich Himmler directly. Now, we also have the telephone transcript of that telephone conversation, where the following day, General Stahl reports back to Pancratius Pfeiffer that, yes, we stopped the arrest at 2:00 in the afternoon. Hitler ordered those arrests stopped because of the special circumstances of Rome. This is one sort of thing. There's another document that I can tell you about. November of 1938, Pacelli was Secretary of State. And they had just, Kristallnacht had just occurred in Germany. There were 204,000 Jews left in Germany after Kristallnacht. Most of them had left, had been able to leave, but there were 204,000 left. We have the letter downloaded on our website. It's in Italian and in High Latin, because you have to learn how, everybody knows the Vatican speaks in its own language. You have to be able to read between the lines. It's called Vaticanese. At any rate, so in this letter, he sends a telex to 65 bishops and nuncios around the world asking for visas for these people. Then he sends another letter 3 weeks later, the beginning of January, again saying, you must get 200,000 visas for quote unquote non-Aryan Catholics. So many of the researchers say, yeah, he only helped converted Jews. So you're telling me that there were 200,000 converted Jews in Germany? Is that what you're saying? This is the logic that some of these critics use. And so in the High Latin, it also says that you must not just get visas for these people. You must also respect their religious precepts, their religious manuscripts and books, and their religious institutions. Now, why would you say that about a Catholic? You wouldn't. In fact, from this effort, there were 3,000 visas for Brazil that were granted. 2,000 went left unfilled. They went to the Brazilian embassy in Germany, was never used. 1,000 went to the Vatican. 1,000 was used. Those 1,000 Jews were sent, and then Pacelli actually took his own personal money to pay for it, because we have documents where he's complaining, how come you're charging us so much money for this, you know? And they actually sent them to Brazil. 1 week later, the Brazilians said, these people are practicing Judaism. They had Shabbat. And so they were practicing Judaism. So then they started curbing it. They said, no, they had to be sure they're back, because they gave out baptismal papers, false baptismal papers. The Vatican is, as everyone here knows, is one of the biggest small countries in the world, with 1.3 billion followers and believers, faithful. But they have no army. They don't have the means to protect itself. But they still act. They have listening posts and have an ability to do things. We have one interview which we got from Margherita Marchionne was incredible. Mary and I went to Provence, France, to meet with Monsignor Giovanni Ferrofino. And Monsignor Ferrofino was a young priest at the time who worked directly for the Pope. And he said, if you look at it's in Italian with English subtitles, if you go to our website, Ferrofino actually says that, the Pope sent me to Portugal to get visas for Jews. He says, but I couldn't tell the president of Portugal the emotion that he used. And then Ferrofino goes, he said, the Pope would say, why don't the Americans see? Why don't the Spanish see? We have to save this vibrant community. And he'd hit his hand on his knee. So he would send him to Portugal to get visas. He'd always get the visas. They would come back. And by the way, those visas were also repeated to us when we went to Vienna. The Vatican was sending money for the support of the Israelite community in Vienna, and it talks about those visas in Vienna. So we know that this all happened. Everything fits together like a glove. And so he'd come back, he'd get the visas. Then he said that he was transferred to become the assistant to the nuncio in Port-au-Prince, Haiti, and the Dominican Republic. And that was Monsignor Silvani, was the name of the archbishop who was the nuncio, who was a very sickly man. But then Ferrofino says that, he said that I would get, what would happen is they, every time the Vatican could get a ship, they would separate the men from the women so they can get as many people on as possible. It'd be about 800 Jews they would send over. And he said that I went over in the chaplain's cabin. So I said, there were 800 Jews and 6 Catholics. I was the chaplain on the ship. And he talks about this. He said, but when he got there, two times a year, from 1939 to 1945, he would get a double encrypted telegram directly from Pius XII, where he would actually have to use the cipher system to decipher it. And in the telegram, they said they'd have 825 Jews that needed visas. So he would have to get in a car with the nuncio, drive 1.5 days from Port-au-Prince, Haiti to the Dominican Republic, where would they meet General Trujillo. And he said, it was always the same. The general would be up on his horse, and the nuncio and I would come in there, and it had to be the nuncio, couldn't be the archbishop, couldn't not be the religious leader, It had to be the Vatican's ambassador, the Vatican's representative. And he would stand before him and he would say, in the name of Pius XII, we need 842 visas. And Trujillo would always grant the visas. And they'd get them back and they would do this. That's 11,000 Jews. And by the way, Schindler, what did he say, 1,400 or something? They did a great movie about him. This is one instance that I found, you know, through, with the help of Sister Margarita. But we have thousands of situations like this. We have another one. This I love this because, you know what? If you Google me, you're going to see there are a lot of people attack me for this. Because a lot of people have made a lot of money going after the Catholic Church using this man. And I'm not going to stand for that. I don't stand for it. So the good thing is that it's on the internet. Once it's on the internet, it stays on the internet because we're going to have so much fun because the little birdie said that the archives are going to be open very soon. We're hoping within the next, by January, we may get an announcement. We're not sure yet, but you'll never be sure. But once that happens, all of this stuff is going to be changed. It's going to turn around. And we, the dummies from Long Island, are the ones that are going to be saying, well, wait a minute. You're the distinguished ecclesiastical professor from Harvard University of Church History, Kevin Madigan. And you, Susan Zuccotti, are the professor of Holocaust Studies at Columbia University. And on, every one of these people. And we have shown you all to be idiots. In fact, I keep saying, I said that the only solution to this is to get rid of the concept of tenure. These people have got to be, you got to get rid of them. Because they're really not teachers, they're not professional, they're not scientists, they're liars. Most of this stuff happened with, I got a little kennel cough when I was up in Rome. Thank you.
It's not Roman water.
This is great. Thank you. But, the problem is that we've got all of these people who've done, and the principal one, the one I think is the most famous, is John Cornwell. John Cornwell wrote Hitler's Pope. John Cornwell is a liar of the highest order, and I'll tell you why. First of all, if you look at his book, Hitler's Pope, I have the, if you look in there, you'll see the picture of the original cover of the book, and that is where, if you look at the little credit for the photograph, you're going to see that it says that March 1939, Cardinal Pacelli leaving German headquarters. The fact that he was elected Pope March 3rd, 1939, and he left Germany in 1929, never to return, is irrelevant. But this was actually Archbishop Pacelli attending von Hindenburg's birthday party in 1927. So this is the sort of stuff he had. When he came out with his book, Hitler's Pope, he deceived the Vatican. The reason I know that is because Father Gumpel, who was our very close friend, he met with him. And so he arranged for him to have access in the Vatican archives. And he claims in his book, and when he was promoting his book, that he spent months on end going through the records of Pius XII as early as 1912. What's the facts? When he went to the Vatican archives in the year 2000, they only opened up to 1914. So he went from 1912 to 1914, number one. Number two, according to the sign-in sheets, he spent 3 hours over a period of 2 weeks. That's it. Why? He doesn't speak Italian. He doesn't speak Latin. He doesn't speak French. He doesn't speak any of the languages that this stuff is written in. So it was completely useless. He came up with incredible statements. I can show you just as an example of how they twist stuff. He talks about one situation that I think is wonderful, things that Pacelli did when he was nuncio in 1917. The chief rabbi of Germany, was Rabbi Werner, went to Pacelli, who was apostolic nuncio, and during the celebration of the tabernacles or Sukkot, they have used palm fronds, and the palms were being held up by the Italian government in Como, and they wouldn't release them. So according to John Cornwell, Rabbi Werner went to Pacelli and he refused to do anything. Well, funny thing, we went to the Vatican archives and I have 5 pages of letters where he's begging the Vatican to intercede to get these released. And we have each one of these documents. And the fact is he was not able to because the Vatican did not have diplomatic relations with Italy. And so they wouldn't do it. He failed in that he couldn't do it, but he didn't fail because he didn't try. He tried desperately. And in fact, if you read the translations of this stuff, it shows you the passion in which he did it. He said that we must get these documents, we must get these palm fronds. There's only 2 weeks left before we can distribute these to the Jews of Germany and everything. But if I tell you how many times he has interceded on behalf of Jewish people from the time he was nuncio, even before that, you can never possibly accuse him of being anti-Semitic. And I try to tell the critics this, but you know, again, and they don't want to listen to me. I don't know anything. But just to give you a quick beginning, Pacelli's best friend growing up was Guido Mendez. He was an Orthodox Jewish boy from Rome. Every Shabbat, the Pope Pacelli would go to his house for Shabbat dinner. He would learn to speak Hebrew. He would borrow the books of the great rabbis. He actually saved Guido Mendez's life in 1938 by sending him to Palestine. He became a very famous thoracic surgeon. Bruno Walter was just to give you, these are a few examples that we found because we have them from all kinds of references. Bruno Walter was the maestro of the Munich Philharmonic. And one of his Jewish, his pianist from Russia was jailed for anti-Semitic reason, and they were gonna execute him. And they said they did everything to try to get him released and nothing helped. So he went to Pacelli, and Pacelli said, I will do what I can. He got him released. The guy's name was Osip Gavrilovich, and that was in 1917. Osip Gavrilovich ultimately married Mark Twain's daughter. I mean, it shows you some of these things. He actually was responsible for the creation of the modern state of Israel beginning in 1917, when the head of the World Zionist Organization, Nachum Sokolow, went to see him, talking about a Jewish homeland in Palestine. Pacelli was so excited about this that he actually said, you must talk to Pope Benedict the 15th. And he arranged for Sokolow to meet with Pope Benedict the 15th. Then again, in 1925, he meets again with Sokolow with the same subject, he arranges him to meet with the Cardinal Secretary of State at the time. Then again, he tries to get all the Catholics of Germany to join the pro-Palestine organization, promoting this Jewish homeland in Palestine. Then in November of 1947, the vote for partitioning of the Holy Land, Pacelli encouraged all the Catholic countries to vote in favor of it. And that's exactly how that passed. But this is just part of it. The worst part about this, which I can't understand, is that if you read some of the critics, you'll see the Anti-Defamation League hates me. That's all right, the feeling's very mutual. Anti-Defamation League was started by the B'nai B'rith. And they are constantly negative about Pius XII. Constantly, constantly saying things. All of a sudden, we go to the archives. And we find the May 1940 magazine, front cover of the B'nai B'rith magazine article has a picture of Pacelli on the front cover a lead story that the Pope was hiring the Jews being fired by the Italians for anti-Semitic, for the racial laws. And they said the Pope's Jewish scholars. We have so many different examples of this. I give you some others, because I said 76,000 pages, it's very hard to say which ones are more important than the other. There's a very interesting article in the Palestine Post in 1943. You'll see the image of it, where a Jewish German young man goes before the Pope in the Papal Palace, and he tries to speak to him in Italian, and the Pope says, "No, speak to me in your language." He says, "I'm German, but I'm Jewish." So the Pope looks at him, and he said, "Well, what can I help you with, young man?" And he talks about a shipwrecked group of Jews that were shipwrecked off of Rhodes, the island of Rhodes. They were starving to death. I think there were 400 of them, and they need to be rescued. So the Pope said to him, "First of all, whether or not you're better than anyone, only God knows. However, always be proud to be a Jew." And then says it again so all the Germans in the room hear him. Always be proud to be a Jew. 2 weeks later, the guy that Bill Duino did this research, and he did a fantastic job, finds the name of the guy, the Jewish kid, who, by the way, lived a few miles away from me. He died in 2004, but I never met him. But his name is Heinz Winsler. And he tells the story. He wrote an unpublished book, which is on the Leo Beck archives, I think, which talks about this. 2 weeks later, the Italian Red Cross sends a ship to that island and rescues all of the people and then takes them to Campania. Now remember, 80% of all the Jews in Italy survived. 80% of the people outside of Italy were killed. Only 20% survived. And so this was a type of a rescue effort. It was incredible because another book was written by the name of Herskovitz, who wrote The Pope Saved My Life. He was one of the Jews who was saved. But here's an interesting thing. Mary and I went up to Rochester, New York. I was supposed to go up to debate a deacon, by the way, a Catholic deacon who wrote the worst book you can imagine, accusing the Catholic Church of causing the entire Holocaust. And he refused to debate me because when I told him I'm going to show you all the documents we have, he said, well, I don't have any documents, because he based his book on Cornwell's book. But we were up there. I lectured with a man who has his doctorate in history and Holocaust studies from Harvard University and La Sapienza University in Rome, history and Holocaust studies. And he was with me. He actually interviewed the captain of the ship that rescued these Jews. They were all taken to Campania. The Archbishop Palatucci was where he saved hundreds and hundreds of lives. And it's amazing. So we have the way that everything comes together is the most amazing thing here. What I'd like to do is we can give you so many different examples of how the Germans despised him, things he had said about them. And by the way, here's a newsflash for everybody, when anyone ever tells you. In 1930, the German bishops excommunicated anyone who flew the flag, wore the uniform, or became a Nazi, including Hitler. So everyone who says that, why didn't they excommunicate him? Well, they did. The problem is, it was a legal problem, according to canon law, that typically the lawyers screw it up, but I'm sorry, I didn't mean that. Once they signed the Concordat with Germany in 1933, Adolf Hitler was legally elected chancellor. Once they signed that Concordat in 1932, he was elected. They had to legally recognize that as the legitimate government of Germany. Now, many of the critics will say that they recognized the Nazi regime. Absolutely not true. The Vatican does not enter into concordats with friendly nations. It enters into concordats with adversarial nations, setting forth the rights of the church in that environment. And so this is what happened. So according to canon law, they had to lift the ban. Because you're now saying that we've got a legal relationship with this entity, so you can't keep the ban, so it had to be lifted in 1933. But they did do that. We have absolutely so many documents. I mean, the 1938 Pacelli writing, these are handwritten documents. He's writing to the Secretary of State that he's disgusted with Italy adopting the German anti-Semitism and their racial laws. This is an interesting letter which we got March 3rd, 1939. This is the day after Pacelli's election to the seat of St. Peter. The United States wanted to know what this new pope was going to be like. And so he writes, this American ambassador in Germany writes back to, this was a top secret correspondence. And this is what he writes in his letter. He says, his views, while well known to me, surprised me by asking his opinion about Nazi National Socialism and Adolf Hitler. And his response is, his reviews, while well known to me, surprised me by their extremeness. He said that he opposed unalterably every compromise with National Socialism. He regarded Hitler not only as an untrustworthy scoundrel, but as a fundamentally wicked person. Hitler was incapable of moderation. And he supported, this is very important, he supported the German bishops in their anti-Nazi stand. He's talking about the excommunication. He says that the risk of losing the Catholic youth in Germany was not as great as the consequences to the Catholic Church and the general around the world surrendering to Nazis. So he said, I'm willing to give up, to excommunicate all these Catholics of Germany if they join the Nazi party. This is what he says in 1939. So we have so many different examples of things that he did. He was actually, anyone here with a Valkyrie assassination attempt, Pius XII and his secretary, Father Leiber, were co-conspirators. Because he was actually hatched in the Vatican with Muller, with a German lawyer. was part of this conspiracy. And how do we know it? Because the British archives talks about it. The Vatican, you'll never see a word about this because it would have been a disaster. The British archives have this information. So we have so many different examples of this. Want to ask questions? Okay. This is a good time because I think that it's important that, you guys talk about what you've heard, if you can. And just throw anything at me. Yes, Tom.
Well, you mentioned that there was a very broad complimentary attitude towards Pius XII up until a certain time period. But I've also heard that the real turning point occurred with the publication of a play,
yes,
called The Decadent. And could you comment about the play and some of the forces behind it?
Yes. The play, The Deputy, well, first of all, the conspiracy to go after Pius XII was a Russian superior, was part of the Russian church and the Russian government. They have what's called a disinformation program. The KGB had this. It's operating to this very day in Iran and Syria and Israel and Palestine under the FSB. They do exactly the same thing. It's disinformation. And so Stalin and Khrushchev both despised Pius XII because he was anti-communism. They both despised the Jewish people, vehement anti-Semites. And the Second Vatican Council was convened, and this is where the church was starting to come together and changing its opinion on its relations with other faiths. So in one operation, which we found out is called Seat 12, was the conspiracy to destroy his reputation, divide Jews from Catholics, to create this terrible schism, and to destroy the reputation of the Catholic Church as well, with one act. Now, what was this? There was a German communist by the name of Rolf Holkopf who wrote a play called The Deputy. And everyone saw, they actually made a movie about it called Amen. And so what the play was actually 7 hours long, so then it was rewritten by Erwin Biskotter, who was a very famous German communist producer. And then it was strategically played in New York, London, Tel Aviv, all owned by communists, those theaters. Herman Schmulen owned the one in New York. It won a Tony Award. And so instantly, the man's reputation was destroyed. Now what happened? The Russians tried to do this in 1945. We know this because when I was doing my research with the newspapers, we saw some articles. The Russians called him Hitler's Pope in 1945, except everybody was still alive. They said, how can you say that about this man? This was a great hero to everybody. So it fell flat on his face. They waited one generation. This time it took. It's 48 years. Until now, it's called the Black Legend, and I gave an interview in Rome, and I said that, and I was going to tell you this before, this is the one thing I said, that I said the Black Legend has been bleached white by the stark light of truth. And that's exactly what's happened. Now, how do we know this? Yad Vashem officially changed that placard 2 years ago. It's not positive, but it's at least a little bit more balanced than the former one. The former was completely historically incorrect. You'll see in the book here, you'll see what it actually said about him. And then we responded to each one of the things, each one of these accusations. And so these are the sort of things that that we were able to uncover. And I have to tell you that the only ones you hear about are these little, I call them revisionists, historical revisionists. Nobody very prominent, but we've got some of the most prominent historians in the world that say we're 100% right. Sir Martin Gilbert is a Jewish historian, the official biographer to Sir Winston Churchill. His interview is on my website. You're gonna hear him say, Gary, you gotta get him Righteous Among Nations. You gotta get, he suffered a stroke recently, so he's unfortunately. Meyer Mendez, who was Guido Mendez's son, he's alive today because of Pius XII. Professor Edouard Husson, who is the Chancellor of the Sorbonne, he and I are now doing a new book together. Professor Lamour Yagil, who is an incredibly important Israeli professor of history. Joseph Lichten, Michael Telekotsu, who heads one of the Holocaust museums in Israel. Richard Breitman, Pincus Lapide, Geno Levi is the world's expert on the Holocaust. He came up with a particularly important statement. He said, He says it's General Levi is the expert on the Holocaust in Hungary. And he actually made the statement about Pius XII. He says, it's a particularly regrettable irony that the only man in all occupied Europe that did anything to alleviate the suffering is today made the scapegoat for the failures of all of the others. That's the problem. And so, yes.
And there is a stunning exhibit called the Holocaust Museum. And going through that, I've noticed there is a section on Pope Pius XII.
When were you there? When was this?
2011.
Okay, right. Mm-hmm. Yes, it is. Yeah. We actually did. We did that. That's why I said the exhibit is Yad Vashem, and they did correct that placard. Happened in 2012. That's why I asked you, when did you see it? They, as I said, it's not perfect, but it's much more balanced than the former statements were.
It doesn't go as far as here.
Yes, it's not going to, because in Israel, it's a very hot political issue. I went on Israel National Radio, and I gave a speech about this, and I was getting call-ins and so on. But everybody was very nice who called in. Every one of them said, yeah, the church saved my mother. My father was dressed as a priest. He had learned the Hail, you know, all this. Yes. Okay, we actually submitted Pius XII's name to be recognized as righteous among nations. I would not deliver the documents because, again, they don't really love me very much over there. So I had the chief rabbi of Ephrat Israel, his executive director, actually hand-deliver the documents. They haven't done anything. They haven't looked at it. But understand something. It's a very hot political issue there. By changing the placard, it has been changed, it's been modified. It's like tearing a bandage off. They've got to do it slowly. Don't forget, they get all their funding from the government and from private people, so they have to do it slowly. What we have been doing is that through the Vatican's ambassador to Israel, I haven't done it recently because they've really got everything they need, but when Franco was there, whenever we'd come up with one of these diamonds in the rough, I would email it to him. He would print it and he'd hand deliver it to Yad Vashem. So this went on for three or four years. And then finally, he sends me at 4 o'clock in the morning, he calls me, he says, they changed the placard. Yeah, well, they changed it. It's not great, but it's much better than the last one. You'll see the last one in this book. It's terrible. Really wrong. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
Is there truth to be a statement for, maybe it's been a long time, that the chief rabbi of Rome
Yes, that's absolutely true. His name is Rabbi Zoli. And this actually is probably the real reason that the Roman Jewish community is so upset. Because he was chief rabbi during the war. And there were all kinds of instances where when the Germans were going to arrest the Jews of Rome, they told them, this was just a trick, they said that if you come up with 50 kilograms of gold, we will not arrest you. So all of the Jews of Rome chipped, they got all their rings and everything else, and they were able to come up with 35 kilograms. And then they went to the Pope, and they asked him if he would help. He says, even if I have to melt down chalices, we will give you whatever you need. If they'll accept cash, we will do anything you want. But he ultimately never had to do it. A lot of people think he did, but he didn't. The Catholic families of Rome put their gold in the rest of the 50 kilograms. So they turned over the 50 kilograms to the Germans, they laughed, and they started arresting them. So yes, his name he converted to Roman Catholicism and took the name Eugenio. Then his wife converted a year later and took the name Eugenia. Now this does say something. You know, everybody, we talk about this, that there are many paths to the top of the mountain. Needless to say, this is probably the biggest reason the Roman Jewish community is so upset about this. You know, it would be one thing, this is the chief rabbi of Rome converting, and he had a vision. Everybody has to walk a path that God lays before him. You know, I, funny thing is that I'm in Rome so many times a year and so on, and we have interviews, and a British interviewer who said, you know, you're here all the time, and you're very devoted to this church. I said, I am. I said, the Roman Catholic Church is the largest provider in human history of healthcare, education, and benevolent acts of charity. Doesn't come close. Nobody comes close. Except, I mean, but it's filled with humans. They have frailties and everything, but it's constantly attacked. I protect, I defend it. And I said to them, they said, well, would you ever convert? They said, never. I said, I walked the path that God laid before me. And just like Jesus Christ, I was born a Jew and I will die a Jew. Anybody else? Yes, sir. Yeah. Yes, the actual Pincus Lapide was a Israeli historian during the war who lived, and he calculated that, for example, you'll see in the book a telegram that Pius XII sent to the regent of Hungary that saved 200,000 Hungarian Jews. That we're not even talking about the instances that we found, like going to 11,000 going to the Dominican Republic. We had others going all over the place. But the estimate is 847,000 Jews. Now, understand something. 847,000 Jews in 1949 is like 4 million today. In the entire world, there are 16 million Jews. There are actually more Scientologists in the world than there are Jews. And we said it's 25% of the world's Jewish population is probably alive because of the actions of the Roman Catholic Church under the papacy of Pius XII. Yes? Absolutely. I had a bet with the director of the Department of the Righteous, who's a friend of mine, Irina Steinfeld. I said, dinner's going to be on me, but one day you will honor him, because you can't ignore evidence. You can't. And the whole thing is just trying to get them to look at it. I can't get them to look at it because I'm just what am I? I'm not anything special. But I humiliate them. This deacon up in Rochester, Shalino, he's a retired family court judge. And I say, sometimes I get a little excited because we do these Twitter things back and forth. There's a Franciscan, Happy Franciscan is his number. And he asked me questions, how come Shalino won't debate me? And I was supposed to debate him. I said, because he has no basis for anything he said. He just bases his book on this stuff. And then I said, well, it's the old saying. He said, what do you call a lawyer with an IQ of 90? Your Honor. But I like to try to bait them a little bit, because this guy actually was supposed to debate him. He actually, I got the head of the Jewish community. I'm going up in August. Mary and I are going to Rochester. And I said, what are we going to, the head of the Jewish community said, well, what are we going to debate? So Shalino said, let's debate. Could Pius XII have done more as the vicar of Christ? I said, well, isn't that sort of like asking how long has it been since you stopped beating your wife? The same kind of question. You can't answer that. Could he have done more? How do you know? Let's debate. Was he anti-Semitic? Was he silent? Was he a Nazi collaborator? Let's debate exactly what everybody accuses him of. And then the attorney said, well, we have something called discovery. And I expected if you're going to make a statement, you're going to show documented proof to support your statement. I said, it's going to be my honor to send you everything. But I expect Mr. Shalino to back up all of his statements. And on the phone, he actually said, I can't. I don't have any documents. But he still goes around. You go to Rochester, he's a real big shot there now. He goes around to all the Jewish communities and he builds up this hatred. And he's constantly talking about this, and I find it disgusting. And he's gonna be one of my, and I'm not vindictive, but this is a guy who's a deacon in the Catholic Church, supposedly. But these are my, trust me, I don't have problems with Jews when we have these, I have problems with left-wing Catholics who just have, for whatever reason, they want to attack the church, and they do it through this. That's who I only have. And I can tell you, Paul O'Shea from Australia, this guy is an absolute idiot, but boy, I mean, he's a professor and everything, and Susan Fleming, she's a Catholic at the Holocaust Museum and everything. These are the people who come up with some of the most bizarre things. Alberto Maloney, prominent church historian in Rome, in Italy, he's in Bologna. We had our symposium at the Sorbonne. This guy, first we have Robert Ventresca from Canada, and we're going, Michael Hessman is reading document after document after document and on and on and on. So Ventresca says, because I recorded this, Ventresca said, Well, we can't let a few scraps of documents determine evidence. Well, wait a minute. You don't have anything. You don't even have anything. And you're determining evidence from that. Then Maloney gets up. He says, I refuse to allow my students to use any form of evidence in determining history. Immediately, the whole room breaks up and laughs. And says, that's the stupidest thing I've ever heard anybody say. But he actually said it. So we're now doing a new book with the Chancellor of the Sorbonne. He's going to talk about it. He's not naming him, but he's going to tell him what he said. This is the sort of argument. There's nothing to support anything they say. Nothing. That's the bottom line of it. But they don't want to... I'm getting the sign. What time is it? I'm getting the sign to shut up. Okay. Any other questions?
Gary is justly enthusiastic about this topic, and perhaps that's an understatement in describing how intensely he feels about it, but I suggest we should all feel equally intensely. If you would take a look at the back of the program on tonight, there is an excerpt from the address of the great John Paul II, who went to the Great Synagogue of Rome in April of 1986. At the end of it, John Paul said, let us be faithful to our most sacred commitments and also to that which most profoundly unites and gathers us together, faith in the one God who loves strangers and renders justice to the orphan and the widow, commanding us too to love and help them. If we might, let's recite together the psalm that the Pope then read. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. Let those who fear the Lord say, his steadfast love endures forever. Amen. Thank you, Gary and Meredith. Thank you for all you've done to foster the relations of human beings who love one another. Thank you very much.